Thank you, thank you, thank you very much. And welcome to Cats and Dogs here on Press TV with me, Lembit Öpik, where we are celebrating a ceasefire. This is not a ceasefire by Cats and Dogs, by the way. Our unwinnable war against other people's stupidity continues. No, I'm, of course, referring to the stop to the fighting between Palestine and the Israeli regime. The tension was originally over, or should I say, under the dome of al-Aqsa Mosque. Yet the main issue became another dome, the Iron One, designed to keep all the Palestinian rockets out of Israel. But that Iron Dome seems to be a bit rusty, or in non-technical terms, a bit rubbish. Because loads of rockets fired from Gaza landed in Israel. During the 11 days of the recent conflict, the great fear of attack on their homes meant that some Israelis preferred to spend their days and nights in the streets out of fear of Hamas rockets hitting their houses. So I guess Uber made a lot of money, acting as mobile hotels. Though I doubt the room service was much good, unless of course you have the Just Eat app. Other Israelis seem to have considered fun times on the beaches of Tel Aviv. But that was, how shall I put it, not all sunshine and smiles. It's like Hollywood movies, except in Hollywood movies, people usually run away from tsunamis or man-eating sharks. But in Tel Aviv, the population is dodging the fallout from a dodgy dome. Despite having what the Israelis themselves claim is one of the strongest militaries in the world, they had to accept a ceasefire after a short war with what are often portrayed as stone-throwing kids in the open-air prison that is Gaza. These state-of-the-art weapons seem to have been fairly useless in helping the occupying regime against Hamas's homemade rockets. It's a bit like going out for a picnic and the whole thing is ruined because of one wasp you just can't get rid of. Ever tried killing a wasp with a state-of-the-art weapon? That's got a sting. Confusingly, the Israeli regime accepted the ceasefire just a few hours after it said it would continue fighting until it reaches its goals in Gaza. Does that mean the goal was the ceasefire? So in that case, why start the war? And the strange thing here is that the Israelis stormed the al-Aqsa Mosque just after the ceasefire. Yes, you heard me right, just after it. Did those soldiers not hear about the ceasefire? A bit like those soldiers in World War II who lived on islands for years thinking they were still fighting the war. Or to the Israelis, does ceasefire mean stop shooting at us so that we can continue attacking you in safety? Imagine if that approach is adopted by the Israeli football team. Wait until the end of the match and then score the winning goals after the game is over and the other teams left the pitch. FIFA might have something to say about that, but if they do, they'd better watch out, just in case Tel Aviv calls a ceasefire and then invades the FIFA premises after everyone's gone home for the weekend. The recent ceasefire has revealed an interesting mathematical curiosity about Israel's military activities. With each conflict, the duration seems to be reduced by 11 days. One of their wars in the 21st century took 33 days. Then it took 22 days. And now it just took 11. They also destroyed an 11-story tower in Gaza, which coincidentally housed the offices of Al Jazeera and the Associated Press. Maybe that's why they're trying to have 11 general elections every month too. But I digress. The Israeli regime reserves the right to self-defense, which seems to also extend to acting against reporters who dare to report the more savage aspects of their activities. Associated Press seems to be in on it too. The AP news agency seemed to sack a US reporter called Emily Wilder for her past Palestine activism. Maybe they should have sacked her a little bit sooner because, and I'm just speculating here, the Israeli regime perhaps destroyed the tower with her office in it as a kind of hint. I mean, if you turn up to work and it's just a big smouldering pile of rubble, it's a good clue that you're not expected at work tomorrow. And being fired is just two letters different to being fired on. Anyway, if we follow the 11-day reduction in each conflict, I predict that the next war will take less than a single day, maybe just 11 hours. One morning in, say, the holy month of Ramadan, Israeli forces will fire at Muslim worshippers in the al-Aqsa Mosque, followed by an immediate ceasefire. Or, to save even more time, Mr. Netanyahu can declare the ceasefire before he even declares the war, to confuse the enemy so much that they'll just surrender because they don't know if they're meant to start or stop fighting. That also gives him more time to hold even more elections, where he can apply that same logic and declare the result void before he's even held the vote. The only small problem with all this is that if Israel begins the war after it declares a ceasefire, the United Nations won't have enough time to express its grave concerns about the escalation. And Biden won't have enough time to say he's not going to do anything about it anyway. I've heard the Israeli soldiers watch cartoons to pass the time between wars. But it does seem that the way these wars are going, the military is also getting a lot of its military strategy, like attacking the tower, from the Pink Panther. And if you haven't seen those films, take a look. Peter Sellers, very funny man, has never actually declared war on anyone, except, of course, in Dr. Strangelove, which was actually hardly any less crazy than the Israeli attacks on Gaza. It's also crazy that even the most powerful men in the world seem to have started making jokes about this exceptional army.
Рассказать вам анекдот про израильскую армию. Молодого солдата спрашивают, если вот если на тебя идут там, ну скажем, 20 террористов, что ты будешь делать? Я возьму УЗИ и буду стрелять. Молодец. А если на тебя идут танки, я возьму, значит, гранатомет, буду защищаться. Молодец. А если вот самолеты летят, и танки идут, и еще террористы наступают? Он говорит, господин генерал, а я что, один воюю в нашей армии?
Wow. Of course, Mr. Putin told that as a funny joke. In reality, it's something like this. The commander asks the soldier, what will you do if a reporter with a microphone approaches you? The soldier answers, I'll ask for a drone to hit him before approaching me. Problem solved. And it's quicker than doing a long, boring interview when the soldiers should be preparing to attack as soon as the next ceasefire is declared. Incidentally, one interesting point is that the Associated Press seems to have had no problem with the Israeli regime blasting their office, thanking the regime for letting them leave the area safely. What's next? How will they cover all-out war against the Palestinians? In this exclusive special report, we show how the Israelis are helping to build a new and better Palestine by removing the old and bad Palestine using their weapons and bombs of peace. We'll also be asking this question. When the Israelis are willing to spend literally millions of dollars on bombs to get rid of those old and out-of-date buildings, why are the Palestinians so ungrateful? While such a story could well be reported, sad to say that censorship is indeed a key element in the mainstream media while covering conflicts in the occupied territories. News channels such as CNN and Fox News have a habit of covering injured Israeli soldiers and civilians, while YouTube and Instagram remove scenes of terrible carnage caused by the regime because it's graphic material. That said, some celebrities have voiced their anger against the crimes via other media. And as a special bonus prize, if you do decide to research hashtag Paul Pogba, they'll throw in a free visit to your house by the FBI. Absolutely free. And that's all for this week, so join me again next time to find out how long the next conflict will be, how many Israeli elections will occur before that next attack on Gaza, and whether Mr. Putin will continue his foray into stand-up comedy, all at the expense of the Israeli military. That's all on Press TV with me, Lembit Öpik, and cats and dogs.